What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Morbid Curator Podcast. I'm your host, Rock Corpse. And on this episode, we're going to be talking about 1980 Cannibal Holocaust, directed by Ruggiero Deodato. Considered one of the most controversial, if not the most controversial movie of all time. But before we get to that, I just wanted to let everybody know, I hope they had a great Christmas, they have a good New Year, and it was real badass for you guys. I know I did. I mean, I've actually been pretty busy the past couple months. Me and one of the things that I did was me and my dad, he's the real reason that I've gotten into horror and metal and comic books. I grew up with him exposing me to all three of those things. So one of the things that I got to do was see Cannibal Corpse and Immolation in Cleveland, Ohio, at the Agora, which is one of our favorite places to go. We've seen so many shows there. Immolation, which was the first time seeing them, and they're an old school death metal band. That shit was so awesome. It was really cool seeing them. And literally a week later, we went to Cleveland again at the House of Blues, and we seen Aborted, Ingested, and Lauren Ashore. And I'm not even fucking kidding. That was probably the greatest show that I've been to. Ingested, they had a Wall of Death. I've never been in one before. I've been in many pits, but Wall of Death was one thing that I'd never gotten to do. And me and my dad both were at the very front of this thing, which I don't. If you don't know what a Wall of Death is, it's basically the whole crowd splits into two sides of the floor. At the venue, they split up, and the lead singer will like have us wait until there's this like blast beats or a breakdown or whatever the song entails. But once that happens, we all run at each other, and it's just one big ass wall of death where everybody's just pushing on each other. And at this show, I mean, it was the whole fucking floor. Everybody was just running up into each other, lowering their shoulder, pushing, and then it just went into like a heavy ass breakdown, and everybody was just in the pit. It was just so fucking awesome. And we seen Aborted after that, and I mean, it was the same thing, just enormous pit. One of the best concerts I've ever been to. And Lauren Ashore, of course, they were the headliners. They were probably the least that I wanted to see there, if I'm being honest. But they put on a good show. The pit was so crazy that everybody, it was like there was barricades around the whole the floor, and they were so many people pushing on each other that the barricades were coming down, and security had to come and like hold the barricades up. It was just such a fucking badass time. But yeah, so you know, me and my dad went out and did that, and it's really cool going with him to those things, because he's the real reason why I'm even doing this today. It's I'm super into the horror and death metal and the comic books, and he's the real reason why I'm into that. So it's really cool being able to go to those things with him. But speaking of brutal ass things, fucking Cannibal Holocaust, man. I don't even know where to start with Cannibal Holocaust. This is one of my favorite movies. It's just so genius. The more I watch it, the more I realize, like, for an 80s film, 1980, this film came out. It was just genius how Deodato, like, filmed it to make it look so realistic. And I love that there was just no censorship. I mean, it's the things that happen in this movie are so fucked up that it's like beyond words. But to be able to have the balls to put that into a movie, I mean, you earn my respect just from that. I mean, especially in the 80s. I mean, you just don't see that kind of things in 80s films. I mean, obviously you see like some sex and decent amount of slashers and stuff, but you don't see anything like you see in Cannibal Holocaust. Which leads me to my next point. Ruggiero Deodato, he was actually arrested and charged with obscenity, and he was later charged with murdering several actors. But And the fucked up thing is that he made him sign contracts requiring him to disappear for a year after the film, just so it looked more legit, which it did. I mean, to the point where people thought that he actually killed all these people. But they finally got a hold of all the other actors, and they appeared in court alive, so they dropped all the murder charges. But that just goes to show, like, how fucked up and brutal this movie is, that the director got arrested and everybody thought that he actually killed all these people. So that being said, I'm just going to jump right into it. One of the craziest things about this movie, and it's really funny to me, is the music that they play in this movie. It's like super upbeat and like, I don't know, it's like classic 80s music, but it's just so upbeat for what the movie is. Like, and they play it during all of the killings, all the rapes, all the very disturbing things that happen in this movie. They play this jingle, which I play at the beginning of this episode. So that's what I'm talking about is what played at the beginning of this episode. And it's just, I don't know, it just makes me laugh when I'm just seeing all these people getting slaughtered, and there's just like this high, upbeat, feel good kind of, to me anyway. I don't know. I'm into death metal and I listen to a lot of fucked up music, I guess you could say. So maybe it's just seems like it's a little bit softer to me and upbeat. But I mean, if I don't know if you agree, comment in the comment section on the YouTube video and let me know what you think. I think it's pretty upbeat and it's almost hilarious. But yeah, so, you know, it starts out with that. And it shows like a news reporter talking about these four Americans that went to the jungle. And they refer to it as the Green Inferno. It's a jungle in the Amazon. And basically, they came up missing and nobody knows what happened to them. So this, so you meet this Professor Harold Monroe, and he's an anthropologist, and he's been like noted for expeditions, and he wants to figure out what happened to these guys. And so he goes on to this journey into the Amazon to help find the group that came up missing. They also, like, tell you who the characters are. The reporter does. He tells you, like, about Alan Yates, that he was a director of the movie, like, of movies. And they mention Faye Daniels, which is Alan's girlfriend. And then they mention this guy named Jack and this guy named Mark. So those are the four people that are missing in the Amazon, and the professor is going to go and try to find them, or at least see what happened to them. And then it just cuts straight up to this scene where this cannibalistic tribe they're all standing around and they're eating like a human arm. And it's pretty graphic. I mean, it's just literally an arm, probably from the elbow to the fingers, and they're just chewing on it. And so right away you can kind of tell how this movie's gonna go, and it's got my attention at this point already. You know, there's a missing group, and they're trying to find out what happened to them, and then the next scene is a cannibalistic tribe. So I mean, you can kind of already figure probably what happened. And it just shows like these soldiers that are native to the Amazon, that they're at, you know, the jungle, and they just come in there and just start shooting at these people, which later you found out are the Yakomo people, the Yakomo tribe. And one of the soldiers finds a lighter around the neck of one of the Yakomo tribe members. So at this point, you can pretty much factor in that That could be one of the lighters from the American group that was that they are coming to look for. So the plane with the professor in it lands. So the professor gets out of the plane and meets the lieutenant, and they sit down and like discuss the expedition. And the lieutenant gives the professor the lighter that he finds, and the professor already like knows whose it is, and he says it's Faye Daniels, which is Alan's girlfriend. And the professor meets like this guide, and of the expedition, his name's Chaco, and so Chaco shows him the prisoner, the Yakomo tribe member that they have captive, and he mentions that they're not afraid of anyone besides the tree people, and no white man has ever like seen the tree people. So which you end up seeing them later on, but we'll get to that. They walk the prisoner, Chaco tells the professor to like stop worrying about him, because for some reason the professor was helping him, like, you know, he was dropping his shit, and the professor would like pick it up and give it back to him, and Chaco's like, dude, like, stop helping him out, because until they figure out like where this group of Americans is, they're pretty much the enemy at this point. And they come up onto this campsite, and this is one of the controversial scenes. Well, not yet, but you see like a turtle shell. So they get up to this campsite and they see this big ass turtle shell on the ground. They pick it up and they come to the senses that the group that they're looking for probably camped out there. And at this point, I just want to say it's the way that it's shot right now looks pretty realistic for sure. It's especially for an 80s, like if I was watching this in the 80s, it definitely would look realistic. But the second part of this movie is like beyond realistic with the, when they, later on in the movie, they show the two, they show the first group like videoing, but it's, there's only two cameras and they're like videoing back and forth. Like it skips between just those two cameras that the actors are holding. So like, it seems like, you know, there's not like a camera from the outside looking in. So it's just straight up what they're recording. And he does a great job with that, with making it look so realistic that it's like them recording it, right then and there. But so I just wanted to point that out, that it, like, at this point the movie is just brilliantly shot, even before it gets to my favorite part where they show like what happened. But so Chaco shoots a jaguar and runs after it and trips over a corpse, and the corpse, he like recognizes the teeth on the corpse, which I thought was kind of weird that he would know what somebody's teeth look like that, but that's besides the point, I guess. And this scene was pretty badass though, because the corpse was like so zombified, and like, it had bugs and, you know, just maggots and centipedes and shit like coming out of the eye socket and out of his mouth, and it was just a really cool fucked up scene, I guess. And the professor like throws up, which kind of shows like Chaco that, so Chaco's like this dude, he's the guide, and he's just like really, like if you've ever seen Zombieland, he reminds me of Tallahassee off of Zombieland, just how his like mentality, like just he doesn't give a fuck, like he knows it's gonna be like gritty and grimy and brutal and shit, and he just doesn't give a fuck. And this is exactly how he acts, and it's funny in a way. And then like to see the professor throw up, he just knows that like he's dealing with a dude that can't handle what he's about to see. So it's just kind of funny. Then there's another real life animal killing. So that's the other thing. Everything in this movie, every animal that's killed in this movie was a real animal killing, which makes this, like I said, a very controversial movie. This was before, like, that it was against the law to kill animals and stuff like this. So, every animal, I think don't quote me on it, but I'm pretty sure there's 6 killings of animals in this movie. I'm trying to get to all of them so that you can just know what was going on. Obviously, the turtle shell, we'll get to that one later. Like I said, they kind of do a whole it's almost like a second movie. It's like you see half the movie, and then you see the second half of the movie again through the eyes of the first group. And it's just so fucking badass. Like, it's just, I can't express it enough how awesome this movie is. I mean, if you're really into horror and you're looking for a thrill and some brutal ass, like, disturbing, fucked up things, this is your movie. And that's part of the reason why I like it. I mean, it's not kidding when it says that it's controversial. But you get to this point where they're sitting at the camp and Miguel. So it's Miguel, Chaco, and the professor. And Miguel is just like in the prisoner. But Miguel, he's like native to the area, and he's kind of like helping with the guiding with Chaco. And you see him pick up this live muskrat, and he just guts it alive. And it's really disturbing. It's just a muskrat, but you can like hear it screaming and twitching, and you just see him like literally just getting gutted alive. Like I said, it's all real, so it just kind of makes the scare factor a little bit more during these animal killings. And you know, they give the prisoner the muskrat stomach to eat, and he eats that, and I'm pretty sure so they really killed it, and they actually ate the animal when you see them eating it too. And the next scene is pretty fucked up. The cool thing about this movie is it kind of keeps you on your feet too. Like every scene jump is something more fucked up than the previous scene. And this one is a really disturbing one. They're all four looking through the bushes, and they see this Yakumo man and women woman on a boat. They get to the shore, and he pulls her out, and she's all tied up, and she's butt naked. He like ties her to this pole, and he spreads her legs, and he like rapes her with this big sharp rock. Like, he acts like it's his penis. Like, he, it's almost like he's having sex with her with the rock. And it's really disturbing. There's, enormous amount of blood. She's screaming. It's like a real horrific, disturbing thing. And the professor gets up to stop it. And Chaco's like, dude, this is like a ritual. She must have like committed adultery or something. Like, this is something that he had to do or else he'd be killed. So, you know, as if putting a sharp rock in her vagina wasn't enough, he gets a big ball of mud and puts a bunch of like sharp objects in it, like rocks and sticks, and then puts it in her constantly, you know, more bloody. She's screaming, and finally he beats her over the head with the rock that he used, the sharp one at the beginning of it, and just beats her head in. It's super brutal. I mean, there's no, like, you know, a lot of these newer movies, they go away from the scene, and you know what's happening, but you don't see it. But this movie, in this particular scene, I mean, you see it all, like everything. You see the rock. I mean, it's literally going in her vagina, it looks like, you know, it's like very graphic. It's something that I haven't seen in any other movie besides this movie, which makes it a special movie that is just clearly they don't care about censorship. I don't either. If you want to make a movie, do what you want to do with it. And it just makes it a classic movie. I mean, there's more scene. There's another couple scenes in this movie that make it more of like a, like when you think Cannibal Holocaust, you think of this scene, this particular scene. That there's more of that later, but this scene was just so graphic and brutal. I can't even explain it in words. Like, you have to go watch it for yourself to just see how disturbing this is. So he finally beats her in the head with a rock and kills her, and then drags her back into the boat and pushes the boat away. And so Chaco shoots up in the air and tells the professor that they're going to wait. They're going to wait and follow him to see where he goes. Because when he shot the shots, the tribe member just ran off into the woods. And so they follow him. And they get to this open field. And Chaco knows that the Yocomo are waiting for Miguel. Like, so Miguel goes out there in the middle of the field with the Yocomo prisoner that they have. And he strips completely naked. And you see everything. Like I said, no censorship whatsoever. You see many penises in this, many vaginas, anything, you know, just be prepared for that if you haven't seen this already. I mean, I don't know who has all seen this movie, but I highly recommend, if you haven't, to definitely check this movie out. It won't disappoint. It's not for the faint of heart. If you don't like seeing gore, rape, not that anybody likes seeing any of these things, but as far as like the horror movie factor, you know, the scare factor of it, I guess I wouldn't recommend watching this movie, because I'm the kind of dude that doesn't really get fazed by a lot of things. Like, I've seen a lot of brutal ass movies. I listen to brutal music. I've seen a lot of brutal artwork, stuff like this. But this has probably got to be the most brutal movie that I've seen by far. I mean, I don't even know if there's really anything that compares to it. If anybody does know a movie that compares to it, drop it in the comments and let me know. I'll definitely check out whatever movie you guys got that could go up against this as far as the brutality. I'd actually really dig watching something like that. So just please let me know. So they're in the middle of this field, and the Yocomo, there's like a whole bunch of them, and they're in the bushes, and they shoot their like their darts at the feet of Miguel, and Miguel like kicks it away, and then they repeat it, shoot it at his feet. They're just seeing what he'll do, and he's kind of proving that, like it's a peace offering kind of. It's a weird, I don't know. It's, you know, I don't know how it works around there, I guess, but eventually the Yocomo just run back to their camp, and Chaco says that they're going to follow him. So they follow him. And when they get back to the camp, they see like a can of film around this Yocomo woman's neck. And the professor looks at Chaco, and Chaco tells him, don't like say anything. Just act like you didn't see anything. And so he doesn't say anything about it, but one of the Yocomo is trying to like tell them what happened. Cause like everybody's like shook up, all the women and the kids and everything. Like it's almost like they've seen a ghost when they see these guys come into their camp. So like clearly something happened to the tribe, you know, and they're trying to figure out what happened. The chief shows like, brings him over, and he's like, shows this tribe member with like a gunshot in his leg, and he's like trying to tell them what happened, and clearly, like, the professor's kind of gathering what may have happened. The chief's getting like really upset seeing the the bullet in the dead member's leg, and so Miguel shows like them a switchblade. He's just like, he takes it out, puts it back in the blade itself, and like keeps doing it until he gets the attention of the chief, and he ends up giving it to him as like a peace offering. And they end up eating with them that night, and they learn about like the Shimatari swamp people and the Yahomo tree people. So there's like three different cannibal tribes. There's the Yakomo, the Shimatari, and the Yamahomo. And the tree people, the Yamahomo, though, they're like the most they're like the most feared. So then it shows the Shimatari setting like fire to smoke out this tribe and the tree people out of the tree. And one of them falls out, and the tribe like brutally beats the body and drags it. So Chaco, the professor, and Miguel, they follow this the tribe with the dead body. And you see this whole, like, this is probably one of the most brutal, fucked up, like, scenes that I've seen. It's like, there's so much happening in this scene. There's like, they're like all like out in the shoreline, and there's like people getting raped. There's the Shimatari are doing this to the tree people. It's like a very graphic scene. I mean, they're just raping them in the mud. There's they have like these sticks with like big rocks on them, and they're just like cutting, they're like really sharp, they're just cutting this woman in half, and there's just like a lot going on. I mean, it's just like one big orgy of just brutality. And eventually it, like, it shows the scene for, I mean, it feels like a minute or two, and then Chaco shoots his gun up in the air, and you see the tree people coming like from the other side of the shoreline, like the river. I know I've been like talking about it like it's the ocean or something, but no, it's like a river. And so they're on the other side of the river, and they're like coming across, and Chaco did that to kind of make it known to the tree people that they're like on their side, like they're that they're willing to, you know, scare away the swamp people for the tree people. So the tree people welcome them to their camp, and they like are they, and the tree people are like acting weird towards them, and like they just don't trust them. And this is also like another thing that the professor is like, what the hell is going on? Like, why is there so much like distrust with these tribes already? Like, they, you know, they're meeting, like when they met the Yakomo tribe, they were very scared of them, of the American group. And so it's just kind of like, what the hell is going on to these tribes? Like, what's going on? The chief give the chief of the chief of the tree tribe gives them a wristwatch, and it kind of like shows a sign of peace, and they become allies. The professor goes into this river, and there's like six women that follow him into it, and they're like all butt naked, and they're like playing with his penis like they almost like they haven't seen an American penis before or something. And they go running out of the river, and he follows them, and they take him to like this big ball of corpses, which is like super cool scene. It's just like a huge ball, like hanging of just corpses. And the tribe members are like crouched down crying. You can tell that they're upset that they would have for what they've done. And later you find out that it was like, they think it was like evil that they did that. And this was like a way of keeping the evil spirits out, was like this ritual that they did with making them into a ball and just kind of hanging them there. And the more that the professor looks at this ball of corpses, he like realizes that these are the group, the American group that they're looking for. And it's kind of cool. It like shows like picture, it'll show like the dead corpse, but then it would show like a real picture of what that person looked like when they were alive. And they do that for each one of the four corpses. So that's pretty badass that they did that. So kind of just, that's how you really know that that was the first group. You know, it was Alan, Faye, Jack, and Mark. They talk about how the tree people wouldn't let them bury the remains. Like I said, because that was like their sign, like them hanging them was just like a ritual to like get rid of the evil spirits. And the professor is really asking himself, like, what kind of crime could have caused such retribution? Like, he knows for sure that this American group did something very fucked up to earn to become a ball of corpses. You know what I mean? Like, it's really clicking to the professor that maybe it wasn't the tribes that were in the wrong here. The professor's mad and he runs up to the camp and starts shooting into the air to get the tribe's attention. And he plays music from his recorder. He's had a recorder this whole time, just recording the things like the voices and the songs that these tribe members have been making. And so he plays like this song that they sing. The tree people come out of this tree and just kind of like show that they're interested in what's going on in the recorder. And they like lower this mutilated Shimatari member down, and it was like an invite to their dinner. You know what I mean? Like they, the Shimatari that was killed earlier in the day. And this is another graphic scene where they just like are picking and pulling apart this corpse, this Shimatari member, for because they're gonna eat it. And the chief gives the professor a bite of the heart, and he can just like see it in his face that he doesn't want to, but he knows that he has to like earn the respect of these of this tribe. And in exchange for the professor's tape recorder, they give him the cans of film, which this is like a big thing, you know, like now they can finally see what could have happened there that could possibly ended up in the murders of all this, the four Americans that came before them. So now in the movie, we're back to present day. The professor came back. So the whole expedition is done and the professor has came back to the States. So the professor explains to this guy interviewing him that the tribe thought that if they could capture their voice on a recorder, then they could capture their spirit. So that's why they kept the recorders, and they thought, like they kind of like bowed down to it in a way, like it was like a grail in a way that they could capture the sound. And so the professor wants to see this footage because he hasn't seen it yet. Alan's like documentary. And this is where this shit gets fucking wild. Like, up until this point, it's been a very crazy movie. But when you, like, see the second half of the movie, it's just, like, it's so much more realistic. And as you're watching it, you can kind of see, like, why people in the 80s would think that this was real and all of the murders were real. And because it just, I mean, it's brilliant how it just goes together. Like, you see this first part of the movie that's leading you up to what really happened. You know what I mean? Like with the turtle shell and the campsite and the corpse that Chaco tripped over and why all of these tribe members are afraid and why they're so violent towards Chaco and the professor and Miguel. And you know what I mean? You really kind of find out why the American people were killed and mutilated. So the professor gets with these guys that want to make this documentary, and they show the professor Allen's documentary. It's called The Last Road to Hell. And it's a very like graphic movie where it shows like war deaths and people being like executed by like getting shot to death. And and I read up that this is like real shit that you see in this like little clip. It's like real life stuff that happened. So that's also like another scare factor. I mean, it's like real life. This little, it's like a, only a few, probably like 30 seconds of watching this, but it's like real war deaths and kids and shit getting like shot to death. It's like really graphic. And so it gives you a little bit about Alan, the he's like the leader of the first group that went, that the missing group. And he was like the director of the documentary that they were supposed to be making. And so it kind of, it shows you that he's into like real fucked up things. Like he likes the war, killings, and, he likes showing like the brutality in real life scenarios and, things that are uncensored and very vulgar. And then, so now it shows like what really happens from here on out. Like everything from this point on in the movie is all from the cameras of Alan's group. And this is where it gets real, like realistic and shot like a documentary. A lot of people will say it's like the Blair Witch Project and stuff like that, like how it's shot. It's, very realistic documentary style, shaking camera kind of thing. And so like one of the first things it shows is the group at that campsite that the professor came across, and it shows Jack and Mark catching a turtle, a huge turtle, and Faye's recording it. And it goes like back and forth between the recordings of, that Faye has and the ones that Alan has. And they cut the head off of this turtle. I mean, it's very graphic, real killing. Shows them chopping the head off of this turtle, and his like neck and everything's pulsating. You can hear him screaming. And then they cut, like they cut the bottom shell off, and you can see like his internal organs and stuff, and like intestines and stuff, just like pulsating, like a heartbeat type thing. So like, I mean, it's very real. I mean, obviously it is real, but like it doesn't get much more realer than this. And it's a very graphic, it's long too. It's like, it's gotta be like a 3-minute fucking video of them killing this turtle. If you can't handle seeing a animal getting killed, do not watch this movie. I mean, there's so many animal killings in this, and they're very graphic. So I mean, if you're not into that thing, I just wouldn't even watch this movie, to be honest with you. And so like the scenes kind of go quick in this last section, so it's going to be pretty like back-to-back things that are happening. Kind of, I mean, I guess the first half was kind of like that, but this half is really quick, it seems like. Anyway, their guide, so the four Americans had a guide, and he gets bit by a snake and they cut his leg off. And his name was Felipe, and he gets bit by the snake and they just cut his fucking leg off, and he ends up dying. And they're like, well, like, you know, now we're pretty much fucked. Like, there's nothing we can do. We just got to keep moving forward. So it's these four Americans going through this green inferno jungle with no guide. So that's already, you know, not the smartest thing that they could have done, but hey, whatever. And so Felipe is the body that Chaco trips over in the beginning, when I was telling you how Chaco tripped over that body and recognized the teeth. It was Felipe. And so like, this is what I'm saying, where you can see It's like the movie all over again, just in the eyes of the first American group. Like the turtle, now you see Felipe's body. And there's just many more to come. So they come up on this Yocomo tribe, and it's showing the Yocomo tribe cutting the head off, or like the top of the head of this monkey, which is another real life animal killing. And this one's, it's, they're really fucked up because, like, you can hear them screaming, like, and twitching. You know what I mean? It's like a real, you're actually, like, seeing something, a living thing die. So it's like, you know, you can't fake that. I mean, you see it twitching and screaming and all that. And Jack, one of the American guys, shoots one in the leg. And so at this point, as the watcher, you can already see from what we've seen already, you can tell, I mean, the first thing, he doesn't even like try to negotiate or become allies or come in peace, none of that. He just, first thing that they do is shoot one in the leg. I mean, that's already, now we can see why the Yakumo was afraid at first and pissed when they seen the professor and Chaco, you know. But he did it so that they could follow him to their village, because he would go slow. So the professor is seeing this on video and he's like, wow, like like he can see why it didn't go very well for them later. So they follow him to this campsite and they're just walking around. They shoot a pig that's tied to a pole in the head, which I read that it was like a real fucked up part for the actors when this happened, because they shot him in the head, but he was like twitching in a weird way. And he was like still alive for a second. And it like fucked with Alan, and he couldn't even say his lines right. Like the actor could not say his lines right. Because it messed him up in the head that this happened. So that's kind of a fun fact, is like, you know, all of these animal killings and things were happening, but these actors were very uncomfortable also. Like, it wasn't like they wanted to do this. You know what I mean? They didn't know that they what they were in for until they were already there. And then it's like, what are they going to do? I mean, they're in the Amazon jungle. Like, where, you know, these actors, what are they going to do? They didn't really know what they signed up for. But after that, they just, like, started setting fire to these huts, and they were like pushing all these tribe members into the huts and like just setting it on fire and making them stay in there. And like I said, dude, at this point there's like that weird music that plays, you know what I mean, this upbeat. So you're like seeing all this tribe members getting pushed into these huts, these firing huts, and Alan and everybody is all like laughing at him and joking around, trying to push him back into the thing and fucking with him. And there's just this weird upbeat music playing, you know, and it's just like, what the fuck? To me, like I said, it's just like funny. It's like, how is this appropriate for this time, you know, for what's going on in this moment? And I don't know. I always thought it was just real weird that they played it, but whatever. It's the 80s. I mean, fuck it. So then it goes back to the professor sitting on the bench with this woman that wants to make this documentary. And the professor's like just explaining to her how like fucked up it is what they did to the Yakumos. And she didn't really care, it seemed like, so, which was weird. And he was like, what if somebody like just came into your house and like took shit out of your fridge and, you know, destroyed your house, like how would you feel, you know? And it kind of, she kind of like understands it at that point, that it, you know, yeah, that would be pretty fucked up if that happened. So to me, it's like the professor is getting more and more pissed because he kind of got like a friendship with the tribes, you know, with his expedition there. I mean, he realized that it wasn't them that was in the wrong, you know, like this group just came and just started fucking with them, you know, like it was just, they didn't know how to handle it in any other way besides just fucking brutally like murdering these guys, you know. And it just gets more fucked up from here. I mean, there's a part where it shows one of the Yakumo like badly burnt and just like breathing. I mean, you can just hear her like breathing very heavily, like she's about to die. And they're just kind of like laughing at it. I mean, they don't care about these people or anything. So it's just, it's real disturbing, you know, and the acting is very good. I mean, you, especially in the 80s, would not be able to tell a difference between if this was acting or real life. I mean, the actors were so fucking good that they played the part of like just not giving a fuck so well that it was disturbing. I mean, it played a great part. I mean, it made it that much more suspenseful and realistic. And I mean, it just gets more fucked up. They show this pregnant woman that's tied up and she's like giving birth to this fetus, and they pull it out of her and bury it in the sand and then kill her. They like beat her with this rock. All these women just like beat her to death. And it just keeps like, now that we're in the part of the, you know, the first group that went, It's like bouncing back and forth between present day with the professor and what happened in the video that he's watching. So it's like real like back and forth, which is cool. I mean, it's also like a realism effect of they could really be watching this real footage. You know what I mean? And so they walk into this theater. It's with a professor, and he wants to see more. Like, he knows that there's something that they're hiding. I mean, the shit that's been going on is messed up, but he knows that there's worse, probably. And he wants to know why they were all killed. And it shows the group finding one of the tree people. And this is one of the most disturbing scenes that I've seen in a movie, probably. I mean, they just take her and brutally rape her, and the three men, and Faye, you know, the girlfriend, is like disgusted by them, and you know, Alan's her boyfriend, and he's partaken too. And so they're just all taking turns raping her, and they're like laughing, and it's like a joke to them. Like, this, like, it's so meaningless to them, which is very disturbing in this moment. And when they get done, it shows another scene where the woman that they raped is up on a stake. It's from like from her mouth out her ass, like that's how she's sitting on this stake. And another fun fact about this part in particular is the woman, the actor who played this part, was actually sitting on a bicycle seat and held like the top part that was coming out of her mouth in her mouth and like kept it steady. It's like she was such a good actor that she could sit on this bike seat and hold this other piece in her mouth and like sit so still that it looked so realistic. I mean, she looked for sure looked dead on it. But this is one of the most iconic scenes of this movie. I mean, it's on the cover. It's when you think Cannibal Holocaust, you think this scene, this woman on the post, and the tribe did this to her. Because she was raped and like her virginity was taken, you know, she's not pure anymore. So they had to, kill her in this way as a ritual from the tree people. And Alan is not fazed at all. Like, it's so fucked up. Like, they're videoing it and it shows Alan like laughing and looking at the woman on the stake. And the guy who's recording is like, hey, man, I'm recording. Like, you know, don't look like that. And he, like, completely wipes the grin off of his face. And he goes to say, like, oh, she must have been in some type of sexual thing to where they would have to do this, you know, like making it seem like it wasn't just all three of them that raped her. It was so, so fucked up. And so you're like throughout this movie, you're just gaining this hatred for this group. You know what I mean? As the watcher, you're just like, man, these guys are fucked, and they had everything that was coming to them. You know, you don't feel any type of remorse for these guys now. Like, they were fucked in the head. So the next scene, they like, they're in the woods and they're being surrounded by these tree people. And Jack is the first one to die. He gets a spear through his chest, and then Alan ends up shooting him to like just take care of him so he's not suffering, I guess. And then it shows the tribe cutting off Jack's penis, which is very realistic. It's like, I mean, if you could literally imagine a penis getting cut in half, that's exactly what it looked like. I mean, I would not believe that that wasn't real. You know what I mean? Like, it looked fucking real, guys. And then after they cut off his penis, they beat him to death. And like, I mean, they beat him to pieces. I mean, they're just dismembering him. Like, it really looks like a snuff film. I mean, this whole thing looks like a snuff film, but like at this point, it's like straight up snuff film. And they like dance and cheer that they killed Jack, and they're eating him, like just eating pieces of him, ripping, you know, chunks out of his arm with their teeth. And it shows Alan, Faye, and Mark like trapped, like they're surrounded at this point. And they take Faye and strip her naked and brutally take turns like raping her. This has got to be like the fourth or fifth time that there's been rape in this movie. You know what I mean? There's just so much, and that's a big no-no. You know, that's a big thing, especially to have in an 80s film. This, like, it's it was unheard of. Like, a lot of the things in this movie were very unheard of in the 80s. Even now, I mean, like I said, I have not yet seen a movie that compares to this fucking movie. So if you got something that's similar or more brutal or less, maybe a little less brutal, but same standard kind of thing, just let me know, because I would definitely check it out. So they take turns raping her, and then it shows like the men leaving and all the women of the tribe like coming at her and just beating her to death. And then it's that same upbeat music, man. Like, this woman just got raped, and now they're playing this this upbeat, like, I mean, you heard it at the beginning of the podcast. Like, it's just real. It's silly to have that as the music, the background music going on for this. And they eventually just cut off her head. And they chase after Alan and Mark. And it shows, so this is another cool part of this scene. It like shows the camera, so like Alan trips and they're like beating him to death, and it shows like he's like laying on the ground and the camera fell and it's pointed at him, and it just shows him just getting beat, and he's got blood running down his face, and he's laying on the ground and getting killed. And it's just like so realistic. I don't know, it's just, even it like holds up even to today's standards on realism. I mean, if I watched this on like Facebook or something and didn't know it was a movie before, I would definitely, you know, check twice to make sure it wasn't real. And that's coming from a dude who's like really into this horror and like fucked up things. There's not a whole lot that bother me. You know, there's nothing that really that I can watch on a movie that really bothers me. But this movie was definitely like the top one. You know what I mean? Like, if there's something, this movie just had everything fucked up in it. I mean, rape, murder, people getting dismembered, cannibalism, just the way that the characters acted towards the tribe members and stuff. It was just disturbing, you know, but this movie had all of that in it. And so after it shows Alan dying, basically, and the film stops, the professor, like, they're still in this theater, and the professor looks up, and the one guy makes a phone call saying that he wants it all the material burned, and that they're not gonna go, you know, they're not gonna make the documentary because it was just too crazy. And it shows the professor walking out, and he says, "I wonder who the real cannibals are." And the movie ends. Like, it shows the professor walking away, and the movie ends. Now, that was such a great movie. Like, just the way it shows at the beginning, like, these little hints of what could have happened. And then it goes and shows what did happen. Man, like, it's just so genius. Like, Ruggiero Deodato is a fucking genius. And I know that he's not proud of what he did back then with the animal killings, and he's not proud of the movie. But to be able to make a movie and get arrested and have to prove that your actors are still alive, that is just, like, brilliant. I mean, he's got to be one of the most well-respected directors. I mean, that, you can't top that. I don't know of any other movies where the director had to prove that his actors were alive. I mean, that's just insane. I mean, it was the second highest grossing film in Japan in 1983 behind E.T. I mean, and E.T. is a brilliant movie itself. So I can't believe, I mean, that it's just second to that in between 82 and 83. That just goes to show the risk that Ruggiero was willing to take. And he really wanted to get his movie out there with the realism and his idea of how it should have, like, went down, and that he didn't believe in the censorship and everything, and just how everything just looked so realistic. And it was actually all based on a film that he saw about a documentary crew who died while investigating cannibals in Africa. Like, it was all kind of a it was inspired by a real life thing that happened. And another cool thing that I should have talked about earlier that I forgot, when they were killing the monkeys, Deodato intended on, like, using fake monkey brains, you know, in, like, a fake monkey and stuff. But the natives actually talked them out of it because monkey brains were, like, a delicacy to them. So that was kind of wild. Like, they, you know, we're talking about how messed up it was that he had real animal killings and stuff, but, like, the natives, like, that was what they really did. You know what I mean? It was, like, a real life thing to them. A lot of this stuff, I mean, the cannibalism, everything, I mean, it was all real, like, real life scenarios, which made it, I mean, that's probably why people thought it was so real, because, I mean, this stuff happens. I mean, this is, like, a legit thing that happens, in different countries, in the, you know, in the jungles of the Amazon, and with these cannibalistic tribes and stuff. It was just a very cool movie. If I had to rate this movie, I would definitely give it, it's kind of hard to rate it because it's like, what would I rate it on? Like, the brutality, the movie, the way it was shot. I mean, it's a straight up, like, this has got to be my second 10 out of 10, second to Reanimator. This is definitely a 10 out of 10 for me. I love this movie. I've seen it so many times, and I'll watch it so many times more. I highly recommend this movie if you're into this kind of thing. I mean, if you want to see some things that will make you cringe and that are so disturbing that it makes your stomach fucking twirl and stuff, here's your movie. You'll definitely see it in this. Anything that you could get in a horror movie is in this. So yeah, definitely go check it out. I don't know what it's streaming on. I have it on DVD, so I'm not real sure, but definitely check it out if you can. Thanks for listening, guys. Make sure you subscribe to the YouTube, like the videos, check me out on Spotify at Morbid Curator Podcast. I'm on TikTok and Facebook, pretty much all of the big socials. Just check me out if you haven't. If this is the first time hearing about me, please go check out my pages, and any support is awesome. I love just talking about this stuff. It really, it's my escape. I love talking about horror movie, comics, and definitely death metal. I mean, I love talking to you guys. Please leave comments. I'll comment back as soon as I can. I just really appreciate you guys and all the support. Just don't ever, ever, ever forget, guys. Get hip or rot.